V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Cool. Hi, this is Greg Reitman. We're back at T-Radio V on the green carpet with some amazing guests. Our topic this week is about food. Don't we eat that every day? I've got Mark Monroe, extraordinary screenwriter, Marlyn Diaz, nutritionist, and Peter Greenlaw, who's got a new book, Why Diets Are Failing Us. I'm really excited to talk to all three. But let's just start our show. And Mark, tell me, how did you become, or what was your fascination in terms of screenwriting? Why did you want to become a screenwriter?
You know, I kind of fell into it, to be honest with you. I was a journalist. That's where I went to school for journalism, and I started at CNN, and I was writing the nightly news in Atlanta, Georgia, and I was having a lot of fun. And I think I realized after a while that maybe that wasn't the right, you know, path for me. I started to drink like 3 pots of coffee a day. I couldn't take a vacation. And so a buddy of mine got me out here to Los Angeles, and I kind of fell into documentary television.
What was the first doc that you worked on?
The first doc that I worked on was called Once in a Lifetime, and it was about Major League Soccer, the first incarnation of soccer here in America, kind of how America wanted to, or what we do is kind of buy things that the rest of the world likes. So soccer was huge all over the world, but no one was playing it here, and someone said, well, who's the greatest soccer player in the world? Pele. Well, let's get that guy. Bring him here.
Isn't that the guy that does the flips?
Why can't we have him in America, you know? And so it was a really fun documentary, and it was kind of about how or why, you know, you have this term soccer moms and how a lot of little girls play soccer. That was the one thing that stuck in that first kind of wave of professional soccer in America.
Now, it's interesting, just to kind of change the topic, but you make or work on, like, films that are extremely impactful, films that make a difference in our lives. I remember seeing The Cove. What brought that to your attention?
You know, I think a lot of people in this business feel the same way I do, that I'm extraordinarily lucky. I've just been the right guy at the right place at the right time. I've gotten a few phone calls that have been really, like, you know, impacted my life greatly. I never really set out to be, you know, the writer of documentaries or a writer of documentaries. That's the job that I kind of fell into, and I really love, because I think it's becoming more and more kind of a form of journalism. And right now, journalism in America is so divided, so polarized, that you have the left and the right, and you don't believe either one, to be honest with you. Most people don't.
Well, I mean, it's pretty obvious, you know. I mean, everyone's got their issues. And
it used to be, though, it used to be, you know, Cronkite or Rather, you know, just telling us what the news was, and everyone believed, you know, basically that was the news. There wasn't two sides to the news.
You know, it's interesting. I think most people still believe, though, that is the news.
I don't know, man. I think there's a lot of skepticism about what's going on with journalism these days, and I think documentaries are rushing in to fill that void. And so you have a lot more documentaries on issues, current issues, that kind of tackle big problems that can't be resolved with a soundbite.
So let's talk about big problems. You worked on a film called Fed Up. It was up at Sundance this year. What was that like, and how did you get involved with that film?
You know, to be honest, it was eye-opening, and it was very exciting. And I got involved only through a referral. A wonderful director, Stephanie Sogtig, had been kind of chasing this story for several years with some heavyweight help. Laurie David, the producer of Inconvenient Truth, and Katie Couric. Both of those women were, you know, that was their issue. They've spent many years following that issue and working on behalf of that issue behind the scenes.
So what is the issue, and what's the story?
Well, to me, the story is, and again, I kind of came to it late. I'm not a nutritionist. I'm not an expert.
It's okay. We got Marlon and we got Peter, and they're going to get right into it. So, but what
I know just enough to be dangerous, basically. But here's the way I saw it. I looked at obesity rates and the trends in obesity rates. And the way I tackle or try to tackle a lot of these issue-oriented films is to look at them kind of like a court case.
So
the obesity rates fluctuate a little bit, but stayed mainly the same for as long as we recorded obesity rates until around the late 70s. And then they began to climb. And they kept climbing and kept climbing. And so what changed? That's what the question is. Did our bodies change?
Okay. So from like what, 1970 or
77, 78, 79, you start to see a growing obesity rate among not just children but adults overall, rise in obesity rates. So our bodies didn't change.
Okay.
Something changed though. Something had to change because you don't evolve over a course of a couple of years. It takes time. So I think the environment changed is what changed. I think what you saw is...
Hold on, that's a very broad statement.
Well, the environment
of
food.
When you say the environment, okay, yes. You're talking about the environment.
The environment of food.
You're talking about like how we produce,
how we make food.
Okay.
And there was a. Like a lot of things, it started with good intentions. There was a Senate subcommittee on health that was presented with this fact that we thought that some of the food was creating health problems within us, particularly heart attacks. They thought too much fat is causing heart attacks.
Yeah, well, the fat, yeah.
Oh, the fat, exactly. Only the result of that, and it's kind of long and complicated, but the result of that is that the food manufacturers began pulling the fat out of the food. So now you see a lot of fat-free, reduced fat.
Oh, that was the most...
Huge market.
Oh my God, you would see like my mom and my sister, they'd be like, you know, fat-free, you know, foods. I mean, that was like a marketing thing. So what were they taking out of the food? Taking out the good fat?
Just taking out the fat of the food. But when you take something out of the food, when you take the fat out of the food, it doesn't taste very good, to be honest.
Okay.
And they began putting sugar in. And now we're in a world in which you have 600,000 products you can buy at a grocery store, 600,000, and about 80% have added sugar. We've been putting sugar in all the food. So it's not just like M&Ms and candy. It's spaghetti sauce. It's the things you don't think necessarily have sugar in them.
So would we classify, and please Marlon and Peter, you know, chime in, you know, I mean, when we think about fructose, is that a sugar, right? Is that a sugar?
Yes. Well, it's actually naturally in all fruits, okay,
right.
Number one. But the problem is high fructose corn syrup. And I'm backing up pretty much everything that he said.
But what is it about fructose? Say, like, is it bad? Is it good?
Well, I mean, if I can jump in, just again, I know just a little, just enough to be dangerous. Fructose it occurs naturally. Sugar occurs naturally. A lot of fruit has sugar, but fruit also has fiber. And when you have fiber, when you eat fiber, it helps
your digestion.
The digestion of the sugar.
Yeah.
When you slug a Coke. That sugar's going, you know, straight in, like intravenously. There's no fiber there to help with the digestive system, so that sugar becomes fat quickly. It overwhelms your system.
So you're telling me everyone's drinking Coca-Cola, we're just growing our fat muscles out?
Here's a good way to think about it. Nature did not invent orange juice.
Okay.
All right. I mean, nature's so smart. The reason that the fiber is there, in addition to support what Mark said, as far as absorption, it also is there to modulate the release of the glucose into the body. So you're much better off to eat an apple, to eat an orange, rather than drinking orange juice or apple juice.
It's so interesting you say. My mom always says that. She goes, "Don't drink your orange juice.
Exactly.
It's really bad for you." So what are you telling me? Like we're just, it's like an insulin rush when we're drinking the juice?
Absolutely. You get a huge insulin spike. The other big thing that'll make people mad is one of the worst things you could ever do is juice. Because juicing pulls the fiber out of the cucumber, whatever you're putting in your juicer. As a matter of fact, a big study out of England just came out and said, if you want to get type 2 diabetes, start juicing.
Interesting. So we're going to come back. Peter, you got lots of information.
Oh,
it's going to be a lot of fun. No, it's all good.
I get nuts with this.
I know.
So tell me, so what is the story of, wow, we're ready. Our first unbelievable.
I'm done. Good luck,
no,
guys.
No, we're going to come back to Mark Monroe. We're about, I think, are we breaking on commercial? Cool. We're going to come back. This is Greg Reitman. We're on the green carpet at 2 Radio V, and we're going to find out what Fed Up is about and what Sundance is, and we're going to talk with Peter. Thanks, guys.
Epidemic here is worse than previously estimated, much worse.
The message that's been pushed on us, it's your fault you're fat.
Shouldn't be so hard to get them to run around and play, right?
They have voracious appetites and they don't exercise enough.
It's about how active our kids are.
Forget about it. There are 600,000 food items in America. 80% of them have added sugar.
Your brain lights up with sugar just like it does with cocaine or heroin. You're going to become an addict.
You end up with one of the great public health epidemics of our time. This is the first generation of American children expected to lead shorter lives than their parents.
I am 12 years old, and my doctors have said that I am a statistic.
We're blaming willpower, and it's a crime.
Over 95% of all Americans will be overweight or obese in 2 decades.
We're toast as a country.
The sugar industry is extraordinarily powerful. They're in business to make money, not to keep America healthy.
What if our whole approach to this epidemic has been dead wrong?
The government is subsidizing the obesity epidemic.
We place private profit ahead of public health. Systematic political failure.
By 2050, 1 out of every 3 Americans will have diabetes.
Those diseases are being driven by sugar.
This is the fundamental problem nobody's talking about in society.
We could cure 80% of the problem where they prepared the food in the school.
Tomato paste is a vegetable? Really?
Junk food companies are acting very much like tobacco companies did 30 years ago.
I would reject entirely any argument that they are in any way harmful.
Lying through their teeth.
Kids are being told the biggest lie they will ever hear in their lives.
Ronald McDonald never sells to children. He informs and inspires through magic and fun.
If a foreign nation were doing that to our children, we would defend our families.
Years from now, we're going to say, I can't believe we let them get away with that.
You have to change the diet of America.
It's all preventable.
Hi, I'm Moby, and you're watching T Radio V.
Hi, I'm Rob Hubel from Welcome to the Jungle. You're watching T Radio V, aren't you? Radio on TV. Terrible idea.
In TV.
You shut up. Use that one.
Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Hi, this is Greg Reitman. We're back on the green carpet with Mark Monroe, Marlyn Diaz, and Peter Greenlaw. So, Mark, we didn't get to tell me a little bit about what's the story about Fed Up.
Well, the story of Fed Up is really how the director and Katie Kirk followed. For the film, we use 5 children. They actually followed about a dozen over the course of several years, and these children all want to lose weight. They're all overweight. They're all what you would term obese, and they're doing everything that society is telling them to do. They're eating right. They're exercising. They're eating smaller amounts, and it's almost impossible for them to get out of this predicament they're in. And they just want more than anything to lose weight, to be normal. And so the film is really about kind of the common perceptions we have. There's this belief in society that it's all willpower, that you should just be able to just stop eating, start exercising, that you should just be able to do it yourself. But I don't know if everyone kind of understands the how much the food environment has changed. The fact that there's food at the checkout counter of, you know, Best Buy and every gas station. There used to not be food like that everywhere. Your brain is being triggered about food everywhere you go. You can't walk a city block without being inundated with food.
You're going to get me going. I'm not going to talk about unhealthy food. I'm just guessing, but I want to know. I want to stay on point.
Yeah, so, yeah. So the film is kind of an overview of how we in the 70s had a pretty, you know, manageable obesity rate, and how we got to where we are now. Which has a lot to do with the sugar lobby, with the way the government works, and the way the food manufacturers have kind of gamed the system.
Do they talk about, does Montano get popped up at all?
No, it's not. There's
no like bad guy in this, so to speak.
There's no bad guy to that degree.
Okay.
It's more a look at how your stomach works. Look at how sugar affects your head, your brain. Look at how it affects your digestive system. It makes you crave more. When you have too much sugar, your body is not able to tell your brain you're full. You just want more sugar. And so it tries to take these children as examples of what's happened to them, and look at the course of history and how we got to where we are now.
Fascinating. And when is this film coming out, Mark?
May the 9th. It's out soon, and you know it's going to hopefully sweep through theaters throughout the summer and go to places where a lot of people can see it. The powerful women on this film are all mothers. And trust me, they want every child in America to see this film.
And what was it that inspired you about the film?
You know, there's a lot of passion involved with all of these films, but in particular, this film is dealing with. I am a father myself, and it's dealing with kids who are 12 and 13 and 14 who are overweight and obese, and just want a normal life, want to be out of that situation. And it's really heartbreaking when you see that, and especially when you hear pundits out in the world going, well, just, you know, buck up, get some willpower.
Oh, God.
You know, and you realize how the deck is stacked completely against them. It's maddening. So that's, I think, really what fired me up and why I was so grateful to be able to work on the film.
I'm super excited. You know, being a Sundance alumni, I'm super excited that you got back to Sundance again, that it's going out theatrical. I mean, that's a major achievement, and it's going out May 9th. I mean, that's just awesome.
Thank you very much.
I mean, you should just be super excited. Most films usually take about a year after they come out, you know, to find their theatrical release. So it just shows that Katie and Lori, you know, just weren't taking any prisoners and really just, you know, took it to home.
The way the world is going, they just want to get this thing out there as fast as possible, get as many eyes on it as possible, and try to change some lives.
That's awesome. So Peter, tell me, you got a new book coming out.
It's out.
It's out. But before you tell me about the book, tell me a little about your bio. Like, what attracted you to want to write this book?
Well, 11 years ago, I was on death's doorstep, and I was a former ski racer, tried out for the Olympics, and you know, was a world-class athlete. And walked in my doctor's office 11 years ago, and he said to me, if you don't do something drastically different today, you're never going to meet your grandkids. I had a cholesterol over 400. My heart attack risk...
Hold on. You had a cholesterol...
Over 400. My triglycerides are in the 300s. Not good.
What's it, Marlon?
You want to be under 200.
Thank you.
For cholesterol.
that's really high.
That isn't even the worst part. They score your cardiac risk on a scale of 0 to 100. I was at 85.
Did they want to give you statins?
Well, they did. They put me on, so what did they tell me? Diet, exercise, and statins, which I did religiously for 2 months.
Wow.
And I worked out like I was training for the Olympics, because this was about my life, right? After 2 months, I lost 8 pounds. And the scary part was my cholesterol, despite the fact I went from about 5 milligrams a day on statins to 30, 600% increase, my cholesterol only came down 25 points.
That's not a lot.
And a friend of mine that played professional football said, listen, you really, there's this whole new area now about toxins, and this is really why you can't lose weight, okay?
I just want to say, I am so excited that you're going to talk about toxins, because we have a new film, which we're not going to talk about, but, you know, we're just getting into toxins.
Well, on the back of my book, read the first sentence on the top. What does it say?
The enemy is not calories, but toxins.
Absolutely.
So what is it? Is it something, is it an environmental thing that invades our body?
Let me finish the rest of my story that'll lead me into this.
Sure.
Because how did I get into the research?
Yeah.
So anyway, he tells me about this, and I said, look, I'll try anything as long as it won't kill me. I went on it on July of 2003.
What did you go on again, just so we understand?
A very specific protocol to deal specifically with empowering the body to remove toxins, okay? That's the basis behind it,
and
okay?
When did that come out that you realized that it wasn't like the food, but that there was something inside of
you? Well, let me tell you what happened. I started on a Monday morning. You'll appreciate this as a nutritionist, okay? I stepped on the scale on Wednesday morning. In 48 hours, I lost 8 pounds. I lost 12 pounds in 9 days, 20 pounds in 18 days, went from a 42 to a 34-inch waist in 14 days. In 30 days, lost 30 pounds. That's not even the good part of the story. The good part of the story is I go back to my doctor. From the day I started until I came in, it was about 2 months. And he comes in with my test results, and he goes, how much Lipitor are you taking? I said, I'm not taking any at all. He said, well, we got to retest you. I said, why?
Did he give you Lipitor, by
yeah,
the way?
Yeah, I was taking Lipitor.
Do you agree with Lipitor?
No, I don't. But that's a whole nother.
But
we'd
I'd
have
love
to
know
we'd,
why
we have to do a whole
don't,
nother
but
show.
But I want to know why, just simply why you don't agree with Lipitor.
Because one thing it does, it prevents the body from absorbing CoQ10, which is one of the most important nutrients for the heart.
For
energy and all kinds of things. And one of the side effects is something called muscle wasting. Now, do you have a heart?
Of course.
Is your heart a muscle?
Of course.
Then why in the hell would you want to take something that weakens muscle? Tell me, just go down that road.
I wouldn't.
Exactly.
That's why. But
you
know, but the reason why I wanted to ask that question is because, you know, first of all, it gets very personal when it gets to your doctor and when you start talking about medicine. It's a very personal thing, and we trust our doctors.
Yeah, so watch.
If, you know what I mean?
So watch what happened. So my heart attack score goes from 85 to 15 in 7 weeks, and he goes, we have to retest you. And I said, why? And he said, well, this isn't possible, you know? And anyway, I just created this fascinating curiosity, and I wanted to know why. And then by luck, I met this nutraceutical chemist that had invented this new protocol to deal specifically with, it doesn't remove toxins, it's only the body can do it. There's a natural mechanism in all of our bodies that can remove toxins. But the problem is, to back up Mark's point, I have a great quote in my talks. I say, food will never be enough again, period. Although sugar is a problem, it's maybe 10% of the problem. The American Society of Endocrinologists has now identified that what the human body is doing to survive as a species is we're ingesting these toxins in water and air and food. What the body does, it actually takes the toxin and stuffs it in a fat cell.
Yep.
And those fat cells are called obesogens.
Okay.
And, right?
Exactly, and they have their own little hormone-producing society.
Hold on. We got a new term.
obesogen.
And you know, it's sweet. I love it. So for those that don't know what an obesogen is, what is
obesogen?
Obesogen.
Okay, basically what it is, since we've been on this show, we have 100 trillion cells, all of us. We make a billion cells every 60 seconds. So we've made about 16 or 18 billion cells already. Well, naturally, as the way the body goes, part of those have to be fat cells. But now what's happening is we're hijacking those fat cells and stuffing toxins in them, and no amount of exercise and no amount of regular dieting will remove the toxins. They've measured athletes in sweat. There's no toxins being removed in exercise at all. So what's happening, the reason nobody has any energy anymore is part of our energy stores are now being sequestered just to store toxins in.
Now watch this, one more thing.
They say in the study, they say that these obesogens are altering our hormones and reprogramming the human body to gain weight. No amount of diet, no amount of willpower, no amount of exercise is gonna overcome toxins.
Peter, you have so much.
It makes me crazy when I watch TV and have these people come on and say, all you need to do, to Mark's point, is diet and exercise, and somehow we've got 70% of America overweight. I do not believe all of those people are not trying to diet and aren't exercising. That's a bunch of bull.
It's not just people saying diet and exercise, it's companies out there saying, calories, calorie is a calorie.
No, it isn't.
As long as you just, I know, it's not.
Body can't even count calories.
No, I know, exactly.
He's
making a pun about it.
You know, the human
that's
body.
That's the way they sell us products.
Right,
no,
because
I know.
The human body can't count calories. The only way you can measure a calorie is in a lab. When I do my lectures, I say, people, what is the definition of a calorie?
So Peter, first of all, I'm so happy you're here, but let's just...
What he was sharing and what you guys were going about with the Lipitor. You know, sometimes it is necessary to take
a medication. I'm not against
it. But for many, it becomes a Band-Aid approach, and they're not getting to the root of the cause. And the root of the cause is, what are you putting in your body? And that starts with food and anything you're drinking as well. So,
which I think is a fundamental thing, like we were talking before about, like, I remember one time when we go driving on road trips and you got to stop off and you're going to find, like, healthy food. Mm-hmm. There is no thing as healthy food.
That's why I say food will never be enough again, period.
That's what I'm saying. It was almost sad. Like, I remember driving from D.C. to New York and I'm looking for, you can't find it. I mean, it's a fundamental problem that we've sort of, you know, we've lost.
And to what you're sharing, and I'm so happy for you, I've had a client that was 70 years old, came into me with high cholesterol. Her doctor wanted to put her on Lipitor. She said, please give me a couple months. I want to change my diet and do an experiment. Her doctor gave her 3 months. She came to work with me. We changed her diet. We took her off things that had toxins in them, gluten, dairy, refined sugars, things that were inflammatory to the body. Within 3 months, she dropped weight. She's fitting in her skinny jeans again. She's on my site, you know, with a big success story. And her cholesterol went back to normal.
And what was it, Marlon, that you think that was the radical change?
I think it was cutting back down on some of the caffeine and the wine that was turning into sugar and the gluten, dairy. These foods have been tested to be more inflammatory in the body, so they set up a response system, and it really starts with the sugar.
Eat real food.
Are we really going on commercial again? Wow. We are just moving. I want to come back to a technical term before we go on commercial, to this concept of telomeres. Am I pronouncing that right?
Yes, telomeres.
And we're going to talk about that, but We're about to go on commercial. This is Greg Reitman. We're on the green carpet at T Radio V.
Join Dave Navarro and friends for Dark Matter, Wednesdays at 9 p.m. on T Radio V.
Dave Navarro here, Dark Matter Radio, TRadioV.com.
The universe is vast, enormous, huge, full of stars, planets, and matter. Some of the matter is so dense that not even light escapes.
Get on the mic, Frank.
Pardon me, sir. Pardon my reach.
See, and you guys were worried. I think this is going great.
Pardon my reach.
Get the away from me, dude.
You are really beautiful.
Oh, thanks, you guys.
He's one of the most beautiful people I've ever known.
This is pretty much every week. He brings in a guest that tells him how beautiful he is.
Pardon my reach? If you have to reach over me, then don't do it.
He is the straightest gay guy I know.
Dave Navarro signing off. Dark Matter, thank
Good
you
night.
For listening.
Bye.
Dark Matter with Dave Navarro, Wednesdays at 9 p.m. on T Radio V.
T Radio V.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay. Oh, you're and forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor and he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick show, who did you play to Andy?
Oh, is that gonna play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah. So what's wrong with that, Eliza? Yeah.
Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on T Radio V.
T Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Hey, this is Greg Reitman. We're back on the green carpet with Mark Monroe, Marlyn Diaz, and Peter Greenlaw. Peter, I have to say, I'm passionate, man. But you're a rock star, dude. I mean, you really, you know, it's interesting when we all have curiosity, but what your curiosity led you to, and where you are now, and you know, and just the idea of you sharing this information. I want to just talk about a couple of things. So, what is this? TDOS syndrome. Is it Tito's syndrome?
Tito's syndrome, yeah.
What
just,
is this?
I just got actually the trademark from the U.S. Patent Office, and about 10 months ago I discovered this new syndrome called Tito's. The T stands for toxicity, the D stands for nutritional deficiency, the O is for being overweight, and the S is for stress. And individually those things are destructive enough, but when I realized that there was this interconnectivity between all four of them that was magnifying, this is what was making us fat, this is what was making us tired, this is what was causing us to be stressed out. And the statement that I made, food will never be enough again, period. One of the biggest things that's driving all of these is the nutritional deficiency in our food.
So hold on, I want to ask a question. So, yeah. You know, there's a lot of controversy about the idea that, you know, we're nutrient deficient, and the idea is vitamins are the answer. What's your opinion on that?
Well, first of all, vitamins are completely useless in the human body without trace minerals. And trace minerals are the single most important nutrient that we're missing. The trace minerals are basically the periodic table. It's not just iron and calcium, magnesium, but it's like selenium and boron and molybdenum, these tiny, including
zinc.
Gold and silver, zinc, magnesium, that are so important in the body that are gone. The best foods have 10 to 15. We need 70.
No, but it's interesting because I remember getting an article and I was reading it like on like HealthMed or one of these online publications, and they were saying, you know, when you're taking vitamins, like you're just pissing them out.
Right, because if you don't have minerals, anything. The body can't use a vitamin. They cannot use vitamins without trace minerals.
Okay? It also depends what they're made up of, because you can buy products at one store which are not equal to a professional grade, third party tested, high quality vitamin mineral supplement.
Right. So are you saying, like, so for example, I take fish oil, you know, every day. Is my fish oil not working? Or?
I don't know. I'd have to look at it. I would agree with.
Yeah. Well, Marlon's my nutritionist,
well,
so
right.
I
she would. I'm sure she. I'm sure she would tell you the right kind.
Don't get me going on fish oil. That's low in that's no mercury and it's going to be tested.
Right.
So That but, makes a difference.
But back to Tito's.
Yeah.
Tito's is the single most important reason why diets are failing us and people can't lose weight. Because when you have nutritional deficiency, or insufficiency would be a better way to say it, the body doesn't have the nutrients necessary to create the detox to get rid of the toxins.
So this is, by the way, I read this, Deepak Chopra has a thing, the Raj out in Maharishi University talks about detoxifying the body, Dr. Alejandro Unger has got his clean diet. I mean, you're not, I mean, there's such a hot topic, so what's the answer to this? What have you found?
Well, basically the answer is, number one, it's what's in the calorie that is the only thing that matters, okay? It's not about the number of calories or counting them. It's what is actually contained.
Hold on. What does that mean?
That means food is information. Mm-hmm. Food turns things on in the body, and it turns things off.
Especially genes.
Yes.
So are you telling me that I got to have certain types of food, in other words, to activate my body?
You have to have real food that's nutrient-dense, that's been grown locally or somewhere that without a lot of pesticides.
Well, let me give you a dramatic example. UCLA did a study. Yeah. They compared a bowl of spinach in 1953 to a bowl of spinach in 2012. To equal the nutrition of one bowl of spinach in 1943, they estimated in 2012, you'd have to eat 41 bowls of spinach. How's that going to turn out?
So what are you talking about? The DNA of the spinach has changed?
The nutritional density of the spinach has changed. It's every food group across the board. Because with pesticides and herbicides, we've pretty much ruined the soil. There was a report given to the U.S. Senate. It said 99% of the people in this country are deficient in these trace minerals. And then any small difference can cause disease. That report was done in 1936.
Interesting. So you're telling me that so what's the answer, Peter? I don't want people walking out of the show like depressed.
Well,
the answer is I totally agree.
You want to go with real food, but you must now add trace minerals that are completely gone from our food supply. They're gone.
So you're talking about the zinc. Give me what else.
And
you
zinc
about?
Helps with digestion also, right. And hydrochloric acid. So if we don't digest things properly, we can't absorb it. So it starts with digestion, and you need some of these trace minerals for digestion.
We were talking about Dr. Mark Hyman, who's in Fed Up. Mm-hmm. We talks about the intestinal gut. The intestinal gut is impaired, you know, and you got to repair the intestinal gut. I mean,
none of them are talking about toxins. None of them. Not one of them.
No, they do talk about it.
I think what the reality of bodies that are, all of our bodies are toxic, and it's all gotten worse. What we haven't come to the self-realization is how to detoxify our bodies. That, I think, I would say would probably be the rational way to look at this.
Right. And, you know, detox, I mean, in religious circles has been around for centuries. But the challenge today is, all you have to do to detox is stop eating for 4 hours. You'll start detoxing. But as you begin to release the toxins, because you don't have the nutrients, the body doesn't have enough of these very special nutrients. One is called glutathione. Another one's called a polysaccharide, that are capable of pulling the toxins apart, making them water soluble so they can flush out through the liver and the kidneys.
What's your diet, Peter? What are you eating in the morning?
Well, I actually have these very, very special shakes. They're undenatured whey protein from New Zealand, where they use no herbicides, no pesticides. They're absolutely grass-fed. They have 70 trace minerals, and they're loaded with prebiotic fiber, not probiotic fiber. See, where we are in medicine...
So what's in between again? I just want to clear the air.
There's a huge difference between pro and pre.
So what's the difference?
Well, probiotic is, again, reacting to the symptom. You have an upset stomach, you're putting extra flora in, the good.
Isn't it like healthy to take a probiotic at night?
You can do that, but what's better is to have a prebiotic which manufactures the good flora in the body.
So you're recommending taking your prebiotic
Absolutely.
In the morning rather than a probiotic.
Correct.
It's a whole way of thinking.
But it also increases absorption. It also slows down the release of glucose. It has all these other factors within it.
Marlon, you're smiling. What are your thoughts?
I'm just listening. That was great.
Well, what are your thoughts, though? I mean, would you, as a nutritionist, do you prescribe a prebiotic?
For some, but possibly it might be in the shake already in there. Sometimes it's the food that the good bacteria are eating. So I don't always prescribe that, or I don't even prescribe because I'm a nutritionist, not a doctor. But if I might recommend, it's more about the fiber. So it's about getting fiber.
So you talked about calories and food being information. Did this come up in the film at all, Mark?
That's a central point of the film, is that all these companies use this calorie bait to try and sell their products, that, you know, a calorie is a calorie is a calorie. It doesn't matter if you're having Doritos or Cokes or whatever you're having. If you have too many calories and you don't burn enough off, you're going to get fat, and that's just a load of baloney. A calorie is clearly not a calorie, and that's what we try to explain in the film and demonstrate in the film.
And that's in my book.
And that goes back to food is information.
I know, I was going to say, like, food is information, so, like, what...
I think one of the simplest things a child can do, right,
yeah,
is understand that if it has more than a couple of ingredients, it's not real food.
Mm-hmm. That's
pretty much it.
Not to interrupt, Mark, let me shock you. A great new book called Sugar, Salt, and Fat by Michael Moss, Pulitzer Prize-winning writer of New York Times.
In our film.
Spent
4 years of his life researching the food companies, and he identified and they admitted they've created something called the bliss point.
Yes.
The bliss point is the point at which the combination of salt, sugar, and fat stimulates the brain to the fact that you're excited but never full. And they did MRIs of the brains of children and adults. Guess what the model they used to determine the bliss point? Cocaine addicts.
I was going to say cocaine.
Wow. No, I'm thinking, like it's an insulin shot. We're shooting our kids up. I mean, the thing about it, there's so many times where I see people and they're like, oh, yeah, I'm having my shot. And I'm like, why are you drinking that? It's like they're addicted.
Absolutely.
Well, it's an addiction.
Mark Hyman talks about that in his new book, that cocaine, that sugar is 8 times more addictive than cocaine. And it goes back to the bliss point. These companies are really smart. And we become, and our kids become, addicted to the products because of the ingredients that are in there.
I want to just come back to them because I'm thinking, like, as a little kid, you know, when you get those, remember the milk, right? You know, the chocolate and the vanilla. So what's your, I forget, your eyes just went rolling. Is milk good for us?
No adult should be drinking milk, number one. And the problem with milk, the big thing that I just, milk gets a bad rap. It's because we use pasteurization and homogenization. As a matter of fact, it's illegal, even in California, you have to own part of an organic cow to get organic milk. All these problems we see with milk allergies, et cetera, is once we started pasteurization, once we started processing, we had all these problems, okay? See, here's what people don't understand. The human body, guess how many different types of proteins there are in the human body? Different types, do you know?
Not a fan. That's a good question.
350,000 different proteins. If you drained all the fluid out of the human body, 50% of the dry weight would be protein. It's the single most important nutrient that we don't get enough of. And you don't get it from chicken, fish, cows, eggs, yogurt, etc.
Hold on. That's exactly what we're told. Eat your chicken, eat your fish, eat your salmon. So where are we going to get our protein from?
The world's most perfect food, mother's breast milk, is 60% whey protein and 40% milk protein.
So where are we going to get our protein from, Peter?
Well, if you want to get it, you should get it from New Zealand, or there are vegan...
I've been to New Zealand, but what are you talking about?
You're talking about a whey protein from New Zealand, which is completely unpasteurized. It's no hormones, no ingredients. It's the best protein in the world. The amino acid profile, which is what builds the body, okay?
Yeah, I gotcha.
That's the critical one. Now, there are vegans. The problem with most vegans is they're based primarily on a pea protein, which will give you about 20%
of
the amino.
Yeah.
But you need a combination.
Respect,
yes.
With all due respect, not everyone can digest.
Absolutely. That's why I recommend. I agree. I agree. There's still people with whey protein and milk allergies. That's why. But you want to be careful about the vegan protein shakes because they don't have enough amino acid profile.
I love the green carpet. Yeah. Now you've got to understand why the green carpet is good. Because it's bringing the new trend.
I think we're in violent agreement.
Yeah. Well, you know, one thing
right?
I want to talk about,
we're
going to cut to commercial, but we're going to come back and we're going to talk about the people that are making a difference and where you can go and find good, healthy food. This is Greg Reitman. We're on the green carpet at T-Radio V.
On T Radio V.
Bing, bang, bing, boom, right?
Yeah.
Andy D. On T Radio V. Bobbity, bibbity, bobbity, boom. Andy D. On T Radio V.
The Andy Dick Show. Wednesdays from 4 to 6 p.m. on T Radio V.
Wow!
So but we'll do it. We'll do it better when the show actually starts.
Yeah. No.
Let's get digital. Wednesday, 6 p.m. on T Radio V LA.
Crazy Bone would never do this.
Well, I guess.
You ready? That's horrible. Do that over again. Well, I got it. Talk about your show. Ready? Go? Yes? No? Prompt me? Cool. Hi, I'm Greg Reitman. We're here on the green carpet every Tuesday at 2 p.m. here on T Radio V. On the green carpet each week is where art, music, fashion, and entertainment come together with the environment to make a difference in the world. Each week, a celebrity, a musician, an artist, or someone working in the entertainment industry will talk about what they're doing to change the world. Every Tuesday at 2 p.m. here on T Radio V, Radio and TV. I got it, right?
Yeah.
Great.
Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Living at the border.
Hey, this is Greg Reitman. We're back on the green carpet with Marlyn Diaz, Mark Monroe, and Peter Greenlaw. We got a lot of things to talk about. We don't have much time, but Marlyn, tell me a little about yourself, how you got into nutrition.
Oh, I've been on this path for many years. Started in my teens, gained a little weight back in the 70s, and loved sugar. And so I just started searching for diets and things that were going to help me, and then I just got really turned on. I actually did my first term paper in 1978, kind of dates me in 10th grade, on food additives. I just was connecting the body and food at that time, and so just went down the path to school and been on a...
And you have a website called Holistic Nutrition, correct?
Holistic Nutritionista, which will soon be changed over to Marlyn Diaz, but that...
Give me the URL so those that have been watching the show can get a little aid along the way.
It's www.holisticnutritionista, like fashionista, and that's .com, and Holistic Nutritionista, making nutrition fun.
And I'm sure that you and Peter are going to have lots to talk about after the show. So, you know, I want to come back to, what is it, telomeres?
Telomeres.
What are telomeres?
Okay, I'll give you the simplest explanation. Imagine a necklace with beads on it, okay? In all of us, we have 23 chromosomes from the man and 23 chromosomes from the woman. That's 46 chromosomes. In each chromosome is what's called a double helix, or your DNA. That's what makes us up. If we took, you've seen it, it looks like a slinky.
Of course.
If you unraveled it and stretched it and imagined that each piece was a bead, there'd be 100 million pieces end to end. But what they discovered back in, a Russian scientist back in the late, early 70s discovered that only the tips of the chromosome, the last 15,000 of the 100 million pieces of what determines aging, those are called telomeres. At conception you have 15,000, at birth you have 10,000. Over the course of your life,
shrink.
Yeah, every time the cell replicates, you cut off a little piece of the telomere.
And why are telomeres important?
Because it's what determines all the switching inside the DNA, our coding. That determines everything about life and aging.
Are they the life force
They're what controls the DNA. Because when the cell replicates, it's called, not to get too technical, but DNA replication. Basically, it's transcription, where all the information inside the host cell is transferred to the two new cells. Now, all the DNA is there, but as the telomere begins to shorten, the switching mechanism, like all of a sudden at 20, the switch where you didn't have gray hair gets turned off, and now you get gray hair. Over the course of your life, you can lose 5,000 to 10,000. At 5,000, the cells can no longer replicate. It's called senescence. They also discovered, my very good friend, Dr. Bill Andrews, discovered the human enzyme. It's called telomerase, which controls why the telomeres shorten.
This is obviously the crux of the
matter. That's the crux of the thing.
And what is it? Why are they shrinking?
Because the enzyme, this enzyme and gene called telomeres, gets turned off at conception. It's still there. It's just off. So what they've been working on now for more than 10 years is, can we turn it on a little bit? So if you could turn it on just 10%, you'd slow aging by 10%. It's the most fascinating science in the world.
I don't know if we should be living longer, though.
No, it's living healthier longer.
I'm teasing. So let's go back. I want to come back to this whey protein and your breakfast and what you eat, you know, because that's just breakfast. What about lunch? You got to have 20 grams. How much protein are we supposed to have, Marlon?
It depends on your body weight.
Okay, but the average person, 170, 180, 190, what's...
60, depends, 40 to 60 grams.
40 to 60 grams.
So if you get your whey protein in the morning, you still need your protein in the afternoon.
Lean chicken, fish,
you know, something like that.
Okay, but you just said that the chicken and the fish isn't giving us what we want.
Because when you cook it, you basically destroy, like you take a chicken breast, which is, say, 100% protein when you start out. When you cook it, you've reduced it by about 80%.
So let me ask you, if you take the chicken and you put it in...
You can't eat it raw.
Yeah, but if you take the chicken and you put it, like, in hot water, right, and mm-hmm. then you put it in there, is that losing its...
Because you're cooking it.
How do we prepare our food?
I'm sure Marlon will agree with me. The other big problem is because we know that our food is so nutritionally bankrupt, especially like vegetables, you should be eating them raw. Don't boil them. Don't steam them. Don't microwave them. Don't cook them. Because what little nutrients are in there, then we cook them out.
You know, I respectfully disagree on that one. I think it's a combination. Because you want some raw for the live enzymes and the life force, which is good. But some people are not at this stage where they can digest all that raw food. And also they want to extract the minerals from it. So some vegetables, even like the broccoli and the cauliflower, Brussels sprout family, they're meant to be cooked a little bit so they can be digested. And people that have thyroid challenges, they need to have those cooked.
You know what someone advised me? They said they wanted me to take the broccoli. When you boil the broccoli, and it's like that water that's in there, they said don't throw
it's
out the water.
It's great to make a soup.
They said take that water and put it in glass. Put it in your refrigerator and drink the water. And he recommended that I do that eight times in a month.
Minerals,
so it's in your, like,
I used
all
to do that with carrots. Yeah. I would put the carrots in the water and then drink the water.
And then drink the water, yeah. Which is interesting. You're still capturing the essence of the nutrients. So this is really interesting. So let's talk about, like, you know, in the film, is there a call to action?
There are plenty of calls to action. You know, and this is such a huge subject, and you can get lost in it quickly. I think, the most important thing about the film is, I mean, there are a lot of communities out there that don't have access to fresh fruit and vegetables, and I think that's a major problem in our society. We're the richest society in the world, and we're just bombarding people with processed foods. These kind of food substitutes, they're not really food, they're not nutritious in any way, and yet that's the only kind of access they have to food. So I think a big message of the film is, especially for kids who are fighting this weight battle, is to know that you're not alone and that it's maybe simpler than you think, but it's not the cure that has been shoved down your throat for years, which is just get some willpower. No, diet and exercise, mm-hmm. and you'll be fine. No, that's not good.
But what's the call to action? Like, is there a group that they've created?
Eat real food. Literally, eat
so
real food.
Eat real food is the call to action.
Even if our real food today is 80% less than it was in 1940, it's 100% better than processed foods.
Absolutely.
100%.
So if it didn't come from the earth or have a mother, it's probably not real food.
Oh, right. I like that. If it didn't come from the earth, I agree.
If it has more than a couple ingredients, it's probably not real food.
If you can't pronounce the ingredient, don't buy it.
Yeah. And you know what I'm so excited about? Next Tuesday at 2 o'clock, just to plug on the green carpet, will be on Earth Day. How lucky are we?
Awesome. Yeah.
Cool.
I know. So go on. What were you going to say? You were talking about, like, eat real food. That's the call to action.
Eat real food. And to your point, I think having a community, you know, whether it's your spouse, whether it's your family, start to have some meals together, friends. I think I love that phrase, you're not alone, because so many kids and clients that come to me at 50 and 60 years old, they think they're alone. They think they're the only one with a sugar addiction or a sugar problem.
I think it's also really scary, though, too, if you look at the food system and you're thinking about, like, you know, kids that are in middle school and high school and what that food looks like. I mean, this is going to shock the system, so to speak. You know what I mean? Like, we're going to have a real shock. Yeah. You know what I mean? Of, like, they're going to have to, like, hunt for real food.
Well, the beautiful thing about this movie coming out is they're pulling the curtain back. Right? You're pulling the curtain back on what's going on. The books that are coming out, like, the truth is being told. That's what's rising up to the top right now, the truth.
Or maybe the fact of the matter is that people are coming to the self-realization that my kid's not losing weight and my kid's getting really heavy and there's something fundamentally wrong.
Well, when you have kids with diabetes at 10 years old, that's a problem.
Well, and they're also on high blood pressure medication at 10 years of age now.
You know, it was.
Hold on. That's ludicrous.
We're talking diabetes. Diabetes 2, not diabetes 1, where
right.
it's
genetically. It used
genetically
to be called adult right. onset diabetes. Right. No child ever got diabetes. Before 1980, there was never a reported case of a child with diabetes, and now there's 50,000.
Well, listen to this,
growing.
Okay? Right. Of 3 babies born today in this country, 1 in 3 will develop diabetes in their lifetime. 1 in 3.
You think we got a problem? Unless we radically change something.
Unless we radically change something. We just can't. But we keep pretending. They keep rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic. They keep coming on and doing this stuff about diet and exercise, which don't
work.
The
other challenge is that big food knows how to market.
Great market.
Okay?
Well, you know, the interesting thing.
It's natural, gluten-free, whatever the trend is. So I know fat-free. Even in my small
sugar-free.
Corner
sugar-free.
Of the world, teaching clients, turn the food, you know, read the label. If it says sugar, number one, it's not good for you.
So, Mark, I want to ask you a question. So you're going to come back on the show again,
Would
right?
love to.
I'm going to have you back on the show because I don't feel like we've really covered the
we
ground.
Scratched the surface.
I'd actually like to actually take some of those labels. We'll do another one.
That'd be great.
And we'll actually show everybody like what they should actually look for, you know, like what's underneath the covers. Because it's really fascinating when you think about like just the education that's needed. And I want to give another plug. So it's called Why Diets Are Failing Us.
It's on Amazon.
It's on Amazon by Peter Greenlaw, Dr. Dennis Harper, and Drew Greenlaw. And Mark, your film, you're going to let us know what theaters?
Yeah, the website is up already. You can go and
what's the plug on
the
website? Fed Up, is it the Fed Up movie or
Fed Up?
Fed Up
the movie.
One more time.
Fed Up the movie, I believe.
You believe. All right, guys. This is our show. This is Greg Reitman. We're here on the green carpet at T Radio V. What a phenomenal, phenomenal show. Thank you so much, Peter, Marlon, and Mark for coming on.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, guys. Peace. I'd like to make myself believe that planet Earth turns slowly.
You are watching T Radio V. Radio and TV.